Ready, Teddy, let her happen, Captain.
Okay, ready? All right, you guys ready?
Here we go.
Welcome, you're listening to The Best of Investing on Talk 910. This is the show where we present valuable information about real estate, the financial markets, and other economic business of the day. And for those of you listening for the first time, here's our format. A few guys sitting around a bar, having drinks without the drinks, talking business with you, the audience listening in. I'm your host, Edward Brown, and I'm pleased to have as my co-host, Mark Hunt of Pacific Private Money, California's fastest growing private lender, and Robert Spinoza of RPM Mortgage. We have too much fun, this ought to be illegal, I gotta tell you. Our phone number is 888-912.
We're not even cheating yet.
888-912-1190. Write that number down, 888-912-1190, because you're gonna use that number to answer the trivia questions for three vacations given away during each commercial break. That's right, we're giving away 9 vacations during this show, and the vacations are not sponsored by the radio station, but by Lighthouse Resort and Marina, located 1 hour northeast of San Francisco. The vacations are free. Their only request, a $75 cleaning fee to cover housekeeping expenses. Their website is lighthouse4fund.com. You can reach them at 916-777-5511. And today's trivia theme is Disneyland.
Disneyland,
but this is not going to be quite as easy. There's going to be a couple of hard questions, okay? Our website is bestofinvesting.com. Check us out on Facebook and YouTube, and go ahead and click the like button, if you will, by typing Best of Investing Radio Show. We're also on television, Comcast, Channel 26, and AT&T UVerse, Channel 99 on Saturdays at noon, and Sundays at 6 p.m. Mark, you've got some interesting construction information for us.
Well, yeah, you know, most real estate investors know that you know, the two necessary ingredients for a strong housing and economy are jobs, number one, and building permits.
Yep.
And so the good news this past week is that both are up. So, for example, in the California employment market, we've got employment year to date is up. Well, 0.6%, not quite as much as they had hoped. They were looking for maybe 100 to 125,000 new jobs. We're a little bit below that year to date.
That's statewide.
Yeah, statewide. Okay. Statewide, not nationwide,
right.
But statewide. In fact, the number that they have on their statistic is we're up 83,000 jobs year to date through May, not June, but through May. And then contrast that with the fact that construction permits also through May are up 51% year over year.
So even in today's hard political climate, it's still easy to get construction, or easier to get construction?
Well, I think the other thing we've got to look at is, you know, you go back just a few years, and both of these numbers were you know, drastically and painfully down.
Well,
so,
in fact, that's why most people are saying we were in a false recovery, because jobs were not showing growth. Well, because you need job growth to create housing demand, and with housing demand, then you get hopefully new home starts, which
right.
will then fill the available inventory demand.
Well, regarding the permits, I remember Novato had changed and made it easier, mostly in commercial, to get permits, because they were realizing, you know, that they were not making enough money and they needed to issue more permits. So they realized, you know what, if we lower the cost, then we'll be able to get more.
And you think about, I mean, I heard a statistic back in when we were in the doldrums, I heard a statistic from Burger King. And what struck me about that is that one of the things, Burger King derives a lot of its revenue from laborers who work on housing and construction. So, I mean, this goes downriver a long ways. You talk about starting with permits, a number like that, but there's so much that flows from it.
I thought they made money from hamburgers.
Yeah.
Well, you're right on about that, because there's a trickle-down effect.
Yeah,
of
tremendous.
Construction
right.
is one of the largest contributors to the economy and to economic growth that there is. And so it's really important that new housing starts increase, and sooner the better. Now, from my company, you know, Pacific Private Money, we make loans to real estate investors. We're also seeing a lot more applications for construction loans. Now, we're getting those because some of the banks are still, you know, they're still kind of coming back slowly into the market of construction lending. And a lot of contractors out there, quite frankly, they've got dings in their credit because of what happened when the market turned, even though it's now 5 to 7 years later, still that, you know, a lot of them have foreclosures and lost properties, and they're still not bank financeable yet. So they're coming to private lenders for construction funds. And so the point is that not a day goes by that I don't get a request for a new home built somewhere in the Bay Area.
Yeah,
what do you think from the bank standpoint of the construction construction lending, how much are they paying attention to, the FICO scores, whether or not the guy went bankrupt? You know what I mean?
Oh, like, I think on the conventional side, and, again, I'm with RPM Mortgage. We do, conventional lending, a jumbo, but conforming, and all the things that most people, 9 of 10, are going to get when they buy a home. And construction lending is still not at the forefront of what we're doing. It's not come back. I still think most of your big banks and most of your conventional mortgage lenders are not looking at construction as a component of their year. 2013, certainly, and not even 2014. And if they were to view it, they would be viewing it very, very FICO-dependent, very income-dependent, and the scrutiny would be very high. That's my take on it.
Well, and then that's an important point.
Which
so
leads to, yeah.
Frank Dodd created a lot of new regulations in the banking industry, and so if contractors are and home builders are able to get permits, that's only half the battle.
Right.
The next half is, where do I find the financing to build that? So it's going to be important that the banks do get back into the market of construction lending, because quite frankly, as much as I would love to make construction loans privately, I also know that it's expensive, and I can't offer the rates that a lot of contractors will need in this market so that they can make the appropriate profit.
And it's very important when getting a construction loan, don't have any equipment on the property. Because
right. Don't start early.
Don't start early. A lot of people, it's so funny. It's amazing how many times, and you probably get this too.
Oh, I do all the time.
Construction loan. And, a typical bank won't lend if they see the construction equipment. They say, yeah, but we started early to make it simple and let them know we're going ahead. Have you ever heard of mechanics liens?
Yeah.
Well, if you're a borrower out there and you're looking to buy, fix, and flip an existing property or new build, you absolutely do not want to start before you've closed on that acquisition
or
to get that financing. Because, the title companies will do a drive-by, and if they see that any work is started or they see a construction truck out front, they won't close.
Good point.
Very interesting. I don't have much to add on the construction side. We don't, we over the last few years haven't seen it in conventional lending. But one thing I did want to mention, Mark, is that you brought up, contractors and this time horizon of 5 to 7 years. But I deal with contractors all the time. I stay in touch with them, and they're not 5 to 7 years removed from it, because building their pipelines has been a much more arduous process.
Right.
And so, they're in a lot of ways like real estate agents. This recent uptick, this momentum that's built over the course of 2013 is a welcome, improvement to their conditions over the last few years. And I've heard that from many, many contractors.
So if you are a contractor, you're looking at getting a building permit, and your bank is still telling you no, do try us at Pacific Private Money, because even if we can't lend directly, I have got a network of people in the industry right now providing construction financing.
Okay. Tell you what, we're going to go to our first commercial break, and again, the theme is Disneyland. All right, what is the name of the ride that takes you on a boat through a whale? The first three callers with the correct answer. It's not Space Mountain. The first three callers with the correct answer are going to win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Their website is lighthouse4fun.com. You might have to call your 3-year-old daughter. She'll know. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912.
It's my lifeline.
Yeah, exactly. Call a phone a friend. 888-912-1190 to answer this question. What is the name of the ride that takes you on a boat through a whale? 888-912-1190. Make sure to include your name, your email address. Speak slowly. Spell out your email one letter at a time. Don't touch that dial, because the best of investing will be right back.
Good. It's a small world after all.
No.
But that was not it.
That is not it.
I have no idea.
Yeah, I told you, this is not going to be quite as easy.
All right.
Well, I had to make one easy one with one hard one.
Bye.
Thanks.
Bye.
Talk
bye.
To you soon.
Okay.
Bye. It's nice meeting you. Thank you.
Well, there goes our live studio audience.
By the way, how was your seminar?
It's great. This was my fourth, and so I re-upped for another year
with
the strategic coach, and this was probably one of the better ones. Good feedback from my peers, and it was very strong. It was very good.
Excellent.
So I shared a lot of it with Lisa this morning. I couldn't last night.
I used to love Southwest, and now every single trip I do, either outbound or coming back, is delayed substantially. So I purposefully chose the last flight out of
LAX so I can hang and have dinner with some of the peers. And my flight was at 10. I made sure I got to the airport at 9, literally getting out of the cab at 9 o'clock.
Burbank or LAX?
LAX.
Okay.
And I get a text message saying it's been bumped to 11:15. It's like, you know, staying, you know, sitting there for 2.25 hours. It was, oh my God, I would have killed to have been able to stay at the restaurant and hang out with the group and have another beer or two.
Yeah, exactly. Tell you early, then you can do that.
Let me know 2 hours, not an hour before.
The SFO crash.
Yeah.
Eva was coming back. She was supposed to go Arkansas, Texas, LAX, home. She, from Arkansas to Texas, that was fine. But because of the LAX to SFO, she had a 7-hour layover. But she got to go direct to SFO.
The following day?
No. She got her flight because it was early enough. But
so before we start, what do we want to talk about this next one?
Let's see. Well,
I have another one that I don't have in writing, but are either of you familiar with the Jobs Act and the fact that the day before it was on the 10th, it's the 12th, right? Yeah. So on the 10th, a year after the SEC was tasked with coming up with regulations to support some of the new Jobs Act components, they released them on the 10th. And one of them is they canceled the prohibition on advertising for mortgage pool funds.
Well, you said that to me.
Right.
Doesn't that also apply to hedge funds and other things like that?
It does. It applies on a more broad scope, but more specifically for mortgage pool funds, we can now advertise where before we could not conduct any kind of general solicitation.
Right.
Number two, it also opens up the door for the crowdfunding for $1 million and under.
People that aren't accredited investors.
Right. So people have been waiting. So really, that's probably the single biggest component is the whole crowdfunding component of that Jobs Act was one of the most biggest, most popular, and that's the one that will have more of a national and worldwide impact.
So you don't have to worry about having accredited investors now?
No, it's not. No, they still have to be accredited.
Okay.
In fact, actually, that's the key, where before on a Reg D 506 fund, and I won't get it, again, we'll talk acronyms, but on a Reg D 506 fund, which is what I have, I'm allowed up to 35 sophisticated investors, and then all the rest have to be accredited. Well, in order to advertise a Reg D fund, I'm limited to 100% accredited investors. So that's why the guys who designed my funds.
You weren't going to open it up anyway.
No, I didn't want to. Well, you know, you don't want to.
So you can advertise to accredited.
Yes, in newspapers, internet, Facebook, wherever I can make.
So there are regulations that state what must be in the advertisement, of course.
There are, and actually now that it's been approved as of Wednesday, now we're all waiting for the specifics on the guidance.
I'm not sure if you want to. I mean, it's a little sophisticated, but I do have. Okay, I do have the email questions here.
Yeah, sure.
Let's go into those.
I have noticed that the 10-year Treasury rate has increased a lot over the past 6 months. Have mortgage rates followed the same?
Yeah, you can address that.
And Mark, I've been listening to the show for a few weeks. I heard you have a new fund. Is there an advantage to waiting until the fund is larger before I invest? Is there any advantage to investing earlier?
Oh, I like that question. I have a feeling I know who sent that in.
Okay. All right, you guys ready?
Ready. Ready, Freddy.
I was doing when he said Frank Dodd, Frank and Dodd.
Oh, yeah, Frank and Dodd.
Okay, here we go.
And I like that, Mark, when you did this, and when you do that at the end.
Yeah.
Whenever you can.
When you check out the sports econ, Vern Glenn is so funny, because when I do the same thing, he just kind of looks right at the thing.
Yeah.
it's good. Okay, here we go. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hoff of Pacific Private Money and Robert Spinoza of RPM Mortgage. When we cut to the first commercial break, we ask this trivia question. Again, the theme is Disneyland. What is the name of the ride that takes you on a boat through a whale? And no looking on the internet.
It's not It's a Small World?
It's not It's a Small World.
I don't have
There are no whales in It's a Small World. How about Storybook Land? See, that's one of those esoteric rides.
That's my favorite ride.
Yeah, you forgot. Okay, let's get right into email time here. Mark, we have an email from a listener. It says, I've been listening to the show for a few weeks, only a few weeks. God, that rascal. He should have been listening for 2-3 years. Okay. And I heard that you now have a fund. Is there any advantage to waiting until the fund is larger before I invest, or is there any advantage to investing in it earlier? That's actually a pretty good question.
Yeah, getting it.
Yeah, that is. That is. And that's always a concern, I think, for people who are talking to companies that are promoting their what I will call a mortgage pool fund. A mortgage pool fund is a fund where individual investors can invest in a private placement, and their funds are used to make loans. Now, in our case, we make loans to real estate investors, generally no more than 70% of the purchase price. We're doing first trust deeds. We're doing first position loans, first mortgages to real estate investors. That's our niche lending. Those loans are generally short-term and paid back usually within a year. And they pay pretty high interest rates. The notes on those are anywhere from 9 to 11%. And the shareholders in the fund, after expenses, are earning somewhere in the 8% range is what we're generally projecting. But the question is would I want to get into the fund early, i.e. a charter member, so to speak, or should I wait till the fund has grown in size, maybe has a track record, et cetera.
Right.
Well, one of the reasons we started the fund is we have a 5-year track record at Pacific Private Money. We've made over 500 loans, 100 million in originations. We're currently servicing 25 million of that 100 million that has not yet paid off, that we've originated most of those loans in the last year and a half, 2 years. So we do have a track record, but again, getting back to the question, interestingly enough, the early investors in our fund are actually going to be earning a little bit higher than the target rate for the fund. The reason for that is, in our particular case, is that the fund manager is picking up most of the expenses and startup expenses of the fund. So we're not running expenses through the fund. We're just running the note yield and some of the origination points. So the people that are in right now, I think over the next couple of quarters, are going to see actually a boosted return on an annualized basis. And again, we're targeting long-term somewhere in the low to mid, somewhere in the 8% range between the low and high.
So that fund smooths out the individual investor's risk and term on the loan, in other words. So somebody could get into the fund and then they could hold that long-term and they would continue, all of the actual investments within that fund would somewhat be transparent to them.
One of the benefits of investing in a mortgage pool fund is that your investment risk, exactly, is spread among all of the loans in the fund, as opposed
right.
to those who like to invest in whole notes or individual trust deeds,
right.
where they're actually making a specific, they're funding one loan to one investor on one property. The reason that funds are growing in popularity once again is because there are an awful lot of sophisticated private lenders, sophisticated individuals who have a ton of money, and they're snapping up most of the individual
right.
loans that
right.
are made available. And since my company now is kind of steering towards the fund model, the good news for a passive investor or even a formerly active investor in individual trust deeds might want to strongly consider the fund model, because rather than going in and out of a note that pays off every 6 months and then have to stand in line and wait for the next opportunity
right.
and then fight over it with somebody else and then probably lose out multiple times, as some of my trustee investors have discovered lately, rather than go through all that pain, just write a check to the fund and
go
about your business
right.
because you can earn 24/7 on that.
Well, I got an extra little plug here for Mark. He and I went to a seminar on Wednesday and ran into, actually the guy who was putting on the seminar was a very, very sophisticated real estate attorney. He's an investor and he's an attorney. And it turns out that he wrote a check to Mark's fund for $100,000. Now this is a guy who could look through the documents and pick them apart
right,
like crazy,
right.
but he's dealt with Mark before. He looked
great
at the fund.
Yeah,
yeah, it's a great, that's an absolute great testimonial.
Yeah.
And I've looked through the documents myself. I'm looking at it and going, I really appreciate the certain intricacies in the fund that Mark has put in
right.
to benefit the investors.
Right.
Now, the fund is only open to accredited investors. That's most funds have that restriction. But if you want more information, certainly give us a call. Be happy to provide you that. It's Pacific Private Money. We're in Marin County, and the phone number is 415-883-2150. Again, 415-883-2150. We'd be happy to help or send you some information about mortgage pool funds. Or go to the Best of Investing
website.com.
Right.
Okay. Robert, we got an email for you from a listener. It says, I have noticed that the 10-year treasury rate has increased a lot over the past 6 months. Have mortgage rates followed to the same degree?
Good question. And if you're watching anything out there, what I found is the public is watching the 10-year. So over the last 12 months, I don't know. I mean, let's talk about what a lot is, right? So we were at 1.6, and now we're at 2.5, something like that. So, but still, you know, that's a big jump over the last couple of months, especially. Rates have gone up as a result of that. If you were in the 30-year conforming fixed rate market in May, you were looking at April, I should say, you were looking at 3.5%. If you're in that market today, you're a percent higher than that. Just about every index has confirmed that, the Freddie Mac survey, all that kind of stuff. So what do you do about it? How do you treat that? And what impact will that have on the real estate market? We're trying to figure that out right now as we go forward. Is this an irreversible trend? Is it going to continue higher? Or will we see things trend back down to where they have been over the last year? Tough to know, but understand that a lot of what prompted the increase is tied to two different things. One is some relatively positive employment data. You have to put that in perspective too. And does it even keep pace with population growth? Some would argue it doesn't, but nevertheless, the employment numbers are better than they were. And that in turn causes investors to think that the Federal Reserve might end its extremely accommodative monetary policy sooner than some thought. And that's what's causing the spike in bond yields. So I tend to see this as a market reaction more than a fundamental move. And we'll see how the housing market interprets that over the near term, meaning through the summer and into the fall.
Hey, Rob, I got a question for you. So you go from 3.5 to 4.5. That's nearly a 30% increase. I didn't notice any screaming headlines, and maybe that's a good thing from the media going, oh no, mortgage rates are up 30%.
They're catching on now, and I think the public is getting
very misleading, by the way, that headline, if it were in fact out there.
Yeah, and
that's
you have
why
to,
they don't have it.
You have to keep in mind that even at 4.5%, you're still 4% below the historical average on a 30-year fixed loan.
Yep, but don't most people, you know, feel, what have you done for me?
What have you done for me lately?
Yeah,
absolutely.
So you're currently have. I assume you have some loans that you're working on.
Yeah, sure.
Are your borrowers kind of saying, they're probably coming to you and saying, Rob, tell me what to do. Should we, should we close now? I mean, you know.
So this is a great question, and it's a conversation I have all the time. So if you're dealing with a refinance, that's extremely rate driven. But on the other side of that coin, you control the time frame, and you're acting if you can. If you're at 4.5%, rates go to 3.5%, you decide you want to refinance, great. If during the time you're in the process, rates go 4.5, there's no incentive to refinance at all. But
right.
It's your transaction, you control that. Much trickier when you're buying a home, because now your close of escrow is likely set by the contract. It's 30 to 45 days away. You've got to make a call on what's going to happen with this. There are two components to consider. One is, do you still qualify at the higher rate? Okay, that's my job, and that's the kind of thing where those who are in escrow need to know that first. If the answer is yes, then you have to make a call on rates. And I favor locking in what's available. If things get better, you take advantage of it when that happens. There's a saying amongst pilots that it's better to be on the ground wishing you were in the air than in the air wishing you were on the ground. Okay, that's the way you've got to treat interest rates in this environment. We have very high volatility the last few weeks. We've got spikes higher. You don't want to get on the wrong side of those. Get something locked in, again, if you qualify, and then if things do improve, term, you reconsider, you take action when you can.
So there's this house for sale, and there's 20 offers.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in the fourth backup position,
right.
And I'm offering 25% under market, and I have a contingency that says rates have to drop below 3%. Do you think I'm going to get that house?
You might have difficulty on this one.
Wait, okay. I'm just kidding, audience.
But stay positive.
I may be dumb, but I'm not stupid. Okay, we're going to cut to our second commercial break, and again, the theme is Disneyland. What is the only ride that hangs from the ceiling? The first three callers with the correct answer win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Their website is lighthouseforfun.com. And of course, after people understand all these questions, they're going to go to Disneyland and they're going to try to find all this stuff. Okay. And it's not the Abe Lincoln thing. Okay. The first three callers with the correct answer.
Right?
Only when you're sitting in your chair there. The first three callers with the correct answer win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Their website is lighthouse4fun.com. Check them out. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912-1190 to answer this question. What Disneyland ride is the only ride that hangs from the ceiling? Again, 888-912-1190. I see the smoke coming from your guys' ears. Mm. Again, 888-912-1190.
That's my headset.
That's your headset. Yeah, it's blowing up. Make sure to include your name, your email address, speak slowly, spell out your email one letter at a time. Don't touch that dial, because when the best of investing comes back, we've got some interesting articles about health insurance and something called Bitcoins. Stay tuned.
The Winklevoss twins.
The Winklevoss. That line was very funny in that movie.
Winklevi.
I cracked up when he said that.
The Winklevi,
yes,
are promoting Bitcoin. Yeah,
that's right.
I haven't actually read about the Bitcoin.
Is that what it is? They're onto something. Yeah.
That's their latest endeavor. And I'm not sure.
Didn't they make out pretty well with Facebook anyway, though?
Is 10 billion making out?
Okay, no, I just
didn't get. I don't think they got 10 billion.
It wasn't 10 billion.
I think it was that much. I think it was
500 million.
I mean, it was in the millions, I think. I mean,
let's
still,
Google it. How much did
I was helping a borrower the other day, and the guy had $1 million stock payout from Twitter. And I still don't get Twitter.
Okay, I know.
I get what it is. Like, okay, it's real time happening, but there's no substance to what that. Who's watching Twitter?
Well, but
your tweets get bounced off your screen in 10 seconds. I mean, how do you catch anything?
Honestly, I mean, I get things that say, like, oh, Mark Cuban tweeted it, and I erase it. I probably signed up for it.
65 million they got.
So, yeah, that's all. And the thing is, comparatively speaking.
For being a bunch of liars.
Well,
you
stole
my idea.
Well, actually, you saw the movie.
Well, you got the movie.
I know it's just a movie, but it sure seemed like.
It said so on the internet.
Yeah, that's right. The French model. Remember that commercial, you know?
Bonjour.
Bonjour, yeah.
Bonjour. Hey, does that kind of sly way.
Yeah.
Here comes my boyfriend. He's a French model.
Yeah, that's right. It's on the internet.
Bonjour.
Isn't that right? If it's on the internet, it's the truth.
Gotta be
true. Oh, yeah, always.
Always.
Absolutely. All
right. Don't believe anything.
And everything you read.
All right. Okay, we'll get into these two articles, and things won't cover the whole time. So,
although I think they got some, didn't they get some stock options also? So maybe they got.
He probably didn't want them as shareholders. Of course, they could always buy it afterward.
Their pictures. They always show this picture of them. The Winkle buy. They totally look like. Someone that has to.
Quiet. Two silvers.
Quiet.
In my mouth.
You have to extend your pinky thusly.
Whatever.
Okay.
Sour grapes, right?
Yeah, right. Give me that 65 mil.
That's right.
I'll turn it into 30 million in no time. I used to do that. Someone would say, you know, they'd tell me, I'd like you a millionaire. You give me a 2 million, I'll turn it into a million in no time.
That's right.
Okay, here we go. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hoff of Pacific Private Money, California's fastest growing private lender, and one of the smartest mortgage guys I know, Robert Spinoza of RPM Mortgage. Our trivia theme is Disneyland, and the second trivia question, because it's summertime, right?
That's right.
All right. What
we're
is
not
the,
on vacation.
No, we're here in the studio, pumping out this awesome show. Okay, what is the only Disneyland ride that hangs from the ceiling?
Is it Haunted Mansion?
No, because that you're in your chair. Remember that?
I don't remember if it hung from the ceiling.
No. I haven't been there. I haven't been there in years.
All right, what is it?
Peter Pan's Flight. One of my favorites.
That's a good one.
That's a good one. Okay, getting into a couple articles here. Bitcoins. what is a Bitcoin? It's a virtual currency that can be used to buy and sell a broad range of items, from electronics to illegal narcotics. Yeah, baby. And it was created.
Really?
It was created 4 years ago. And yeah, and the thing is, they trade Bitcoins. I mean, it can be traded. The funny thing is, it's almost like you would think that'd be this like illegal underground type of, you know, okay, forget the United States, we're going to have our own currency type of thing.
So Bitcoin, isn't that the company that is co-owned or owned in part by the Winklevoss twins, the Winklevi?
I believe, yeah, let's see, one Winklevi, two Winklevosses. Yes, that is correct. They are part of this company. Yeah, they, let's see, they own 1% of all Bitcoins outstanding. So it's like, reminds me of Bunky Hunt.
So
over,
go over the premise again. So
okay,
how
so,
does this differ from regular currency? And
well, that's what kind of amazes
yeah.
me. Okay, the value of Bitcoin.
Generally, the concepts that are difficult to grasp are the same that don't
usually work
yeah.
out.
I don't know that I'll be buying stock and
forgive my ignorance,
but,
Sarah. But.
Okay, so first of all, they have a value that has varied widely, reaching a high of 266 in the second quarter and a low of 45. Of course, when you trade money, it's always money, isn't
right,
it?
Right, right, right.
Okay.
So
Bitcoins are created or mined from by computers that solve difficult cryptographic problems to verify transactions. I have no idea what that means.
Yeah.
And
is it like barter? That,
yeah,
that's right.
It's
sort
like
of a barter
like
exchange
yeah.
where, the, where you get credits for some,
yeah, but there
some
are,
service or product.
But there are barter exchanges that already exist.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they just don't, they don't actually issue coins, and they don't go up and down in value. It's just whatever you... I don't get it.
I agree with Rob
okay,
that if it's
see.
Difficult to understand, it's
yeah.
probably not going to be the next phase.
Well, get this. Pioneers could mine coins on their laptops. I mean, you know there's going to be some fraud going on there. So, oh, now high-powered...
like mining for gold in the local creek or something.
Something like that. Now high-powered computer equipment is needed.
Well,
but,
okay, so the allure the allure of the product seems to be that what's happening is you are creating the value of... You are creating the value yourself. So this is a technology that is allowing you to create the value that you can then apply to something else. I think that's where it's going.
Well, I guess. Okay, so what happens when you get one of those 3D printers? You know, I'm sorry. Okay, so they've signed up over 4,500 merchants across the world to accept payments. The currency was trading at $90 this past week. This actually is July 4th. Let's see, regulation is unclear. They might be regulated,
yeah.
but they might not. But here's the interesting thing. They don't think that they are securities. So you can trade these
right,
things, but they're not
right.
securities. And so this one guy basically says, Bitcoin is in many ways the cyber version of gold.
Okay.
What?
Okay.
I'll take this and...
Yeah, we should probably talk about
oh,
something
that.
We actually
shot.
Understand on the show.
But okay. Wow, I mean, you know, one of the other things about that is, if you're involved in the creation or the funding of that, what is your exposure to regulation? My God, I mean, how do you predict?
Oh, it's all underground. You just trade
wow.
it like you traded cocaine boxes or marijuana bags or, you know, three
it's
fingers.
It's a family show here.
Yeah.
Well, no. It's,
wow.
I'm not suggesting that. I'm just saying that that's what's out there. Okay, let me change subject here. Health insurers fear young people will opt out. So we have Obamacare.
Blowing up the Obamacare model.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah.
So what happens is, I understand it here. Okay, just to educate the audience,
yeah.
the way insurance works, for like, you know, talk about health insurance, is you hope that you have a whole bunch of young, healthy people in the system
cool.
paying
yeah.
who hardly ever use it, and that helps pay for the older people.
Kind of
right?
like Social Security. People
yeah,
paying into the program
right.
won't use
right.
it until later on, years
or,
later.
Or, yeah, that's right, basically. Okay. So what ends up happening is, like, to give this example, here's a 24-year-old who is fairly healthy, and he makes only $48,000 a year. And if he stays in the system, it's going to cost him $3,000 a year for health insurance.
Okay.
He can opt out, and it's like, okay, well, you got to pay a penalty. Guess how much the penalty is? $100.
So it's less than half of what his premium is.
No, $100 total.
Why would they pay
$3,000 compared to $100?
$3,000 divided by 12 is...
No.
Yeah.
No,
so
we're not talking $100 a year.
Okay.
It's $100,
period.
Period.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. So it's like, what is that, less than 3%?
Yeah.
So
somehow the math on that seems pretty obvious. I think I would go for $100 and
not $3,000
on something.
Okay, but then you got to figure out where you can at least get some kind of insurance. You know, who knows, maybe it'll be an underground bunch of doctors getting
together. But that's not even our argument here, because our argument is Obamacare is working under the premise that what will happen or will stop happening is the exploding costs that are related to people going to the emergency room. You take a young person out of this pool and you put them out without insurance. What happens when they get, you know, when they fall off their skateboard and, you know, break their ankle? Where do they go?
They'll probably go to the emergency room.
Yeah, exactly.
And we're probably still going to have to take care of them like we do all the people who don't have insurance.
That's
anyway.
My point. So it's a double whammy if you're looking at this article that way.
That's a very good point. So they're saying if enough young adults avoid the new insurance marketplace, it could throw off the entire equilibrium of the Affordable Care Act.
Yeah.
Well, of course it does.
So obviously what they'll have to do is the insurers are worrying that the $100 penalty might not be enough of a deterrent. Gee, do you think? You know? And it says here, the penalties jump to $695 or 2.5% of taxable income, whichever is more, by 2016. I mean, can you imagine? They say that, you know, this is not a tax or whatever, you know. What is it, a penalty? You must have insurance.
Yeah, but you know, the thing about it is there's no simple solution, obviously. If there were, it would be in place.
Everyone should stop smoking, lose 100 pounds.
Yeah, well, I'm with you on those.
Yeah.
But still, the fact of the matter is that you can't escape our healthcare system right now. The cost can sink this country, and that's been brought to light in recent, you know, the Bitter Pill article in Time that was very, very extensive and, you know, exhaustively covered.
Yes.
I mean, you're looking at, and so I applaud the Affordable Healthcare Initiative, if only because it moves things down the road to hopefully a solution that can work for the country.
In other words, just changing from what,
yeah,
it's like we got something that's broken.
The path we're on
something.
Is unsustainable. So
no, that's true.
You
just
know,
like Social Security,
right?
It's like
right.
We will eventually go bankrupt. So
somebody's got to deal with it, and you know, and this is a manifestation of it. You know, the perfect being the enemy of the good, and hopefully we can, you know, get around it.
Well, it said here, okay, the cost of health coverage is difficult to estimate because it includes so many factors. But a 27-year-old making $30,000 a year in 2014. Kind of typical.
Yeah.
Will have a $3,400 premium and will be eligible for subsidies that cover about 26% of that bill. The person would end up paying $2,500 a year. That does not include deductibles, though.
Okay.
So that's still a lot of money for insurance.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's a lot of money.
When I was a kid, when I was a very young adult, and I think I had Kaiser, and I think I remember paying about $50 a month.
Right.
I pay less than that for a family of four, and I'm in my 50s, for Kaiser on a monthly basis, I pay less than that.
Wow.
Full
how much you pay total?
About $1,400 a month for a family of four.
Wow. See,
with,
now, okay.
With
I've
the
got,
two principals over 50, my wife and I.
I've got, okay. Here, now, audience, take this into consideration.
And he smokes while he skydives. No,
okay. Okay. No, okay. So I've got Blue Cross.
Okay.
And I'm not necessarily a proponent of them, but I've got Blue Cross. My premium actually got lowered a little bit. I guess because of this affordable.
That must be a mistake, a glitch.
Yeah, well, I'm not
it never goes down.
It never goes down, yeah. It kept going up. But now I pay $500 a month for a family of four. And I'm in my 120s. No, I'm in my 50s, right?
And you have a $500,000 deductible.
Close. No, I got a $7,500 deductible. But again, it goes back to, I mean, we're relatively healthy.
Yeah.
Hardly ever go to the doctor. Mm-hmm. So a high deductible makes sense. I'll save so much money, that $7,500, I'll be able to bank so that if I do need the deductible, it's there because it's a maximum of, you know, $11,000 per family.
And with Blue Cross, you can go to your own doctor. Which
and
is
Blue Cross,
nice.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, well, that's actually really good. Now, of course, now I feel like I'm overpaying.
Can I,
after the show.
Let me throw one thing into that argument, though. So let's take our worst case scenario. What did we say the 27-year-old would pay $3,400 a month before the...
Not that month, a year.
A year, rather, I'm sorry.
A month.
Yeah. They're making less than that. Yes.
Right,
yeah.
So then he would have that reduced to about $2,700 or whatever.
Yeah,
okay. What is that same 27-year-old paying for car insurance during...
Well, it depends on what, if they have bad records.
Okay,
I can't,
but,
I can, Most people are not going to pay $2,500.
No, I know, but let's throw out some numbers here.
$800 a year.
$1,000 a year, I was going to say. Something like that. Okay. But I'm just trying to draw some relativity.
Yeah, but it's hard, because what happens if he's driving a Maserati compared to a 1962 Volkswagen?
Yeah, but a 27-year-old making $30,000 a year is not driving a Maserati either. So, but, you know, where is he living?
Well, that's true.
But
that's an excellent
point.
Stop confusing me with the facts.
Yeah. I resemble that room.
Exactly. Okay. And with that, we're going to go to our third commercial break here. All right. The theme is Disneyland. This one's a little easier. The Blue Bayou restaurant is a neat restaurant overlooking which ride in the dark? The first three callers with the correct answer win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort, which, by the way, has great ambiance, but the food I didn't think was very good about. It's going back about 15 years.
This is the Blue Bayou, not the...
The Blue Bayou restaurant.
Yeah, not our promotion. The food there is great. You were just going into the hotel, the Lighthouse, and then you said the food's not very good. But I'm thinking, you're talking about the Blue Bayou.
I haven't gone to the Lighthouse. Actually, believe it or not, they have a new restaurant operator.
Yeah.
And the food was excellent. Mark and
you
I went up
had,
there for
lunch there over the 4th of July.
Lunch and dinner. It was actually very good.
Delish.
Okay, so the Blue Bayou restaurant is a neat restaurant overlooking the which ride in the dark? The first three callers with the correct answer, we're going to win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Their website is lighthouse4fun.com. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912-1190 to answer this question. The Blue Bayou restaurant is a neat restaurant overlooking which ride in the dark? Make sure to include your name, email address, speak slowly, spell out your email one letter at a time. Don't touch that dial, because we're going to have some awesome stuff here when we return at the Best of Investing. Anyone?
Yeah, no, it was funny.
Be sure to order the crab po' boy.
The way you said it was, you said the Lighthouse, and then you said...
I didn't think I even got... No, I didn't get into
Lighthouse. Maybe it was me, but I could have sworn I heard
that. I usually
do
that, but
then
I had
there,
like,
oh,
yeah.
No.
Don't ask me, I wasn't listening.
<All right>.
Excellent. I hope you're getting this all on tape.
No, no, tape
I want you to go back and see, did I say what he said?
Maybe because I knew it was coming, I jumped on
it. You knew it was coming, and I said before, I think you are... That, I think, is correct. So what's the answer, boys and girls?
I don't know.
Boys and boys? Boy, I
got you. The answer is you did say Lighthouse, and then you went to the food is bad.
Did I really?
See, okay, all right. And she's like, you can't
oh,
say
my
that
goodness gracious.
But I knew your train of thought where you were.
Yeah, so did I.
Yeah.
That's why I jumped in.
Oh, my gosh. Did I really? Okay, well, I'm glad we correct. Thank you for correcting me then. Wow,
like he'd never say. No, I actually remember you guys talking about the food at the Lighthouse.
Yeah.
So yeah, you know.
We had a crab po' boy. We had a pizza.
Yeah.
What else did we have? It was Wiener Wednesday when we were there for $1. That was pretty cool.
Isn't that great?
Is he new this year, or was he there last year?
No, new.
Okay, because spaghetti last year was great.
New and improved.
Okay.
I heard that one of the biggest costs when you buy a restaurant like that are the recipes, and house specialties. So if like you were to buy that restaurant from the previous owner,
you have to pay for the recipes.
You're paying for really? Somebody told me, or actually the guy that told me the story.
They haven't been there long enough to buy it.
Specifically, he was talking about a bakery.
Oh,
and
so buying the intellectual property.
Yeah.
That would make sense. That part of the value.
I guess if it was
a
successful,
thing
too.
That's what makes it so hard to buy businesses. It's like they all have different levels of intellectual property or none.
Want to trade PR? You give me a little PR, and I'll bring in two cameras next Thursday and two cameramen.
Ooh. Oh, you're the man. You were planning on that anyway. That's okay.
Yes, I was.
I know you did.
Well, talk about intellectual property. That's
Okay, what do you guys want to cover in the last 8 minutes?
The last 8 minutes.
I've got this, how difficult is the mortgage process? But we really did spend a lot of time on stuff already.
Okay.
I was trying to look at email for...
8 minutes will go pretty fast.
What's been in the news that...
Well, the crowdfunding certainly has.
Let me just go
back to Google on the crowdfunding. Hang on a second, but I want to make sure I actually have...
Walk Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hahn from Pacific Private Money and Robert Spinoza of RPM Mortgage. When we cut to the third and final commercial break, first of all, we have to make a correction here because Robert was correct. I made a mistake on something here. I had accidentally said that the restaurant, Lighthouse Resort, I said, yeah, the food's not very good. I wasn't talking about that. I was talking about the Blue Bayou restaurant. The food at the Lighthouse Resort actually is excellent. Mark and I were there over 4th of July.
Yeah, when you visit, order the crab po' boy. That was like
that was
really
very,
good.
Very
yeah.
good. Okay. So the Blue Bayou restaurant in Disneyland is a fairly neat, cool restaurant overlooking which ride in the dark?
Don't know.
Pirates of the Caribbean.
Oh, that would have been the one to just throw out there.
Is it Caribbean or Caribbean?
I say Pirates of the Caribbean.
Potato?
Potato, okay. And before we move on to one other thing, I've got to give a nice little plug here to Kramer Herzog, our videographer. He was in the front page of Section B of the IJ.
Good job,
because
Kramer.
He did something called The Eye of the Storm, which was filming the Tukey Williams execution that happened some years back, and he did it from the perspective of filming the like Fox News and all that, because he allowed them to stay in his house. So
right.
It was really kind of neat to see how when the camera was on people, how they acted a little differently,
right.
And some people were very objective, and other people were like, you know, really sincere. Other
That's
people
pretty
were
insightful.
Like, yeah,
Kramer.
So it was really cool.
Yeah.
Check out Kramer Herzog's Eye of the Storm on his website. And let's see, Mark, you had some kind of interesting updated information for us.
Well, there was this Jobs Act passed by President Obama in 2012 in April. Jobs Act standing for Jumpstart Our Business.
Wait a second, something got done?
Yeah. well, when the
jobs.
Some of the components of the Jobs Act included two things that are of particular interest to me, being in the financing business. And one is the whole issue of crowdfunding, which a lot of people have talked about. It's been in the news. It's a big deal. Well, crowdfunding is not yet legal to do, and we've all been waiting for the SEC to issue their general guidelines, and they're very, very close to that. They made progress on July 10th, paving the way by issuing some regulations relating to crowdfunding. And the second part of it is this: most mortgage pool funds are set up under an esoteric ruling of the SEC known as Reg D or Regulation D. And so certain, and those funds generally are not allowed to advertise publicly, and so they've actually lifted the ban on general advertisements.
Can you give the definition of crowdfunding? Because I'm not sure people
And
know.
So going back to the crowdfunding is the what the Jobs Act had intended to do was to create a mechanism where via crowdfunding over the internet you could raise up to $1 million for a business endeavor. And so, but the crowdfunding opponents, and there's a number of companies that have been set up and are kind of poised and ready to assist individuals who want to use the crowdfunding model to raise money for their business idea. They've been waiting for the SEC to actually issue the guidelines. So major progress was made. It looks like earlier this year we were thinking it might not happen until the end of 13 or the beginning of 14, but now there's been some real progress made. So that's the good news, and just getting back to the you know those the syndications under the Regulation D for funds and fundraising above the $1 million, that the ability to advertise is a big deal, because before you could only really expose those opportunities to people with whom you had a prior business relationship, and that just makes it really difficult to raise substantial sums of money. So the whole idea is to, you know, jumpstart the business opportunities within the economy by assisting people who are looking to raise private capital, make it easier to raise private capital. You know, the flip side of that is that we're all going to have to be even more aware of the fact that people will be out there
right.
trying to take advantage
right.
of this. And,
The social dynamics of it are quite interesting.
Yeah, the social dynamics are very interesting, and so they're going to be those the criminal element out there is going to be out there as well. So you're definitely going to always want to be on your guard and do your due diligence with any company that advertises investment opportunities and high returns. transparency is definitely going to be the rule of the day when it comes to these investment opportunities, in my opinion.
With freedom comes responsibility, right? You know, so
is that from Spider-Man?
Did you make that? Thomas Jefferson, I think, close. I don't know. But what I was going to say is, actually, the crowdfunding thing is, you look at it like that, and you could hear a chorus of people screaming, oh, you know, there'll be scammers out there. But on the other side of that argument is when you're unable to access the public, then people make the argument that it's the old boys club, that only, you know, only these people that have, oh, you know.
Only the people with money.
Right, they're the only one, exactly. And so
the man's holding me down.
Yep, so you get arguments both ways, which is why I think it's very, very interesting. Socially.
Which, by the way, I think it's with great power comes great
Yeah.
Power. That was from Spider-Man.
I didn't go to college. Spider-Man. Come on, give me a break.
Have you ever gone to the movies? Peter Parker. Tobey Maguire.
Well, we'll find that out on the next show when we do movies as trivia, right?
That's right. Do these names ring a bell? Yeah, in fact, we're going to do trivia of Indiana Jones movies coming up here pretty soon.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
that'll
the
be
next,
good.
Right.
I'll do good with that. Harrison Ford.
You think so?
All right.
Yeah, that's snakes. Yeah, those are all the answers. Okay, that's all we need.
Show's canceled.
Gee, what are we going to talk about?
Nothing to talk about now.
Summer vacation.
Okay.
Which, by the way, I'm going to Maui in a couple of weeks.
Good for
and
you.
I'll be
here
thinking
today
of
on
you
Maui.
Guys while I'm on the beach at the Grand Wailea, our favorite escape.
Oh, you rascal. Bring me back some sand or something.
Can't do that. It's bad. Yeah. Gosh don't look favorable.
Oh, that's right. There is something about that. You're not supposed to. I did used to vacation with somebody who liked to take a little canister of sand from every beach they visited.
Yeah,
I thought that was kind of cool. But you're right. Bad luck.
Your
bad juju.
Yeah.
Bad mojo. Okay, here's our thoughts for the day. One time, my wife had a suspicion that I might be cheating on her, so I said, "Honey, you got nothing to worry about. I'm not interested in disappointing another woman." do you realize that if Venetian blinds hadn't been invented, it would have been curtains for all of us? Oh, that's really bad. That's so bad, I have to laugh. Even Kramer's laughing at that one. All right, audience, tune in next week to the Best of Investing. We're going to be giving away 9 more free vacations for answering trivia questions. Thanks for listening. On behalf of our team, I'm Edward Brown, wishing you the best of investing. So long.
Well, it goes
good.
And the live studio audience goes wild. Oh,
yeah.
Wait, she left.